video log. This is Andrew, and with me is Riley.
Riley Mercer. I am the comic relief. Apparently.
Supposedly. Hopefully, if you're actually funny.
But also the brains of the operation.
On this episode. Because we're doing electric cars. I know it's incredibly fun. Bear with me through the incredibly funness of it. We're going to talk about how to make the electric car awesome.
You put more batteries in it, so go further. Obviously.
Basically, you just make it as heavy as the sun itself.
We're just going to start using pickup trucks and just fill the entire bed of the pickup truck with batteries.
They've done that before.
Yeah, I know. There's a guy out in Alberta that freaking made a Toyota that was entirely... He did that all on his own.
Yeah. I thought that was pretty cool, but you know what the thing he missed, in my opinion, was?
Speed.
Manual gearbox.
The fuck you want, man?
Yeah, because if you put a manual gearbox, you've got all your torque is at 0 RPM.
Oh yeah, this is true.
Every time you shift up, you've got more torque.
Yeah, but electric motors are they do have a limit to how much they can push.
Yeah.
I mean, their torque is pretty much infinite, but
which is why you always want to keep the torque low, so that it's more infinite.
It's only at a certain voltage. Once the batteries are drained down enough, you're not going to get that torque.
But if, for example, you had an electric car, and you wanted this electric car to be fun to drive and awesome in every possible way, and you decided, let's put a manual gearbox in it, and then you had torque, let's say, like, 200 kilowatts, and whatever torque conversion that would be, at first gear, and then you shift...
Shift back in second, and it'd be like 1.5 times that.
Very little.
Something like that. 2 or so.
Well, torque multiplication increases with every gear downshift, so you actually have less torque with every upshift, but you've got more horsepower. But the problem with electric cars is they have very little horsepower.
They have very little horsepower, but they do have a shit ton of torque.
At 0 RPM.
Yes.
And then, like, once it spins up, the commutator strips and whatever can't keep up with the magnetic fields and blah, blah, blah.
Well, I mean, if you look at the Model S, the Tesla Model S, probably one of the best electric vehicles out there at this moment. They made an RS.
P85D.
I haven't looked it up in a while.
P85D. The one that you see racing all the Ferraris and winning up to 120 kilometers an hour. Because it needs a manual gearbox. Wow. It needs more torque and higher speed.
I believe I pointed you at the Oatmeal article where he describes his Tesla Model S that he has. I don't know what it is now. It's a something space mobile. It's his electric car.
He didn't show me that, though.
Did I not?
I don't think so, no. I did say Rayera, deal with it.
A cartoonist's review of his magical space car.
Yeah, that sounds very interesting. But Koenigsegg Rayera, by the way, on the topic of hybrids and electric cars, the reason it's actually called Rayera is because of the exact reason that we say rain. English instead of Reagan. Sometimes like a president to say.
That's also Reagan.
R-E-I-G-N is rain, for one reason and one reason only. It's because the G is silent, just like it is in Swedish, surprisingly. So every time you think that Dutch, German, Swedish, and all those languages are harsh, angry-sounding languages, Riera. If you said that, you'd probably think it was Italian.
Intergalactic space boat of light and wonder.
Cartoonists have a lot of fun.
Don't they just? He's got... He can go... The thing about the Tesla Model S is that if you're living in the States... I don't know if they have it up here yet, but in the States, they have recharge stations halfway between the cities.
Supercharger stations.
Yeah.
The Teslas.
Or any other... They're supporting any other electric vehicles.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Which is great.
Because you can charge the car faster.
Right.
But you need a manual gearbox to get there faster. Everything is better with the manual gearbox.
See, and the thing is, if you have a manual gearbox as well, is that if you're in a higher gear, you need less power to go the same distance. Because
the wheels are turning faster than the engine is turning because of the gear multiplication. Like the,
right.
The basic function of a manual gearbox.
Getting too technical on this.
I'm sorry, viewers. What's that thing we were always taught in schools?
Don't be an asshole.
Well, maybe you were taught that in schools. I was taught that you have to talk to everybody like they're idiots, which is why I do talk to you like you're an idiot.
Oh, you're funny. it's about the same. It's about the same when I'm talking to you about computers.
So, I'll admit that, yeah. Because forget computers. Computers don't have manual gearboxes. So they don't have all of those.
No, but cars have computers. It does go that way.
But that's just a waste of...
His speechless.
No, it's just a waste of dash space. You could easily have, like, a map setting for... like boost control or the differential settings instead of having a Formula One steering wheel where it's got 18,000 buttons on
it. I wouldn't want 18,000 buttons on my steering wheel. I'd want 18,000 buttons on my dash.
Yeah. Like here where you don't want a camera.
Yes.
Wait, camera. I'm an idiot. Anyways, I actually meant computer.
Hey, look, he admits it.
I just think the whole idea of what's wrong with the electric car really is that they're just boring, monotonous, quiet, automatic pieces of crap.
Not all of them are quiet. There's that one electric Audi where they made engine noises for it, specifically because it's an electric car.
That was a Porsche, too.
Was it?
There was one guy who specifically modified a Porsche so that he would have it like blaring at full volume from the speakers.
No, Audi.
And then he would just cut it off right the second he went past somebody, and it would just dead quiet.
Ghosts.
And he would just go faster after that.
No, just there was a the Audi company actually put speakers on the bottom of the car.
Yeah.
So they had engine noises.
Would that
for
be
the vehicle?
What is that? Their new e-tron system?
Something like that.
They forgot LEC when they were naming that car. It's e-tron, you mean electron? Well, no, because that's not a cool naming convention for a car. Just forget a couple of letters, put a dash, and it's a brand new thing. What are you talking about?
Sounds like naming conventions. That's how that is. All the time.
Prius.
Nah. Let's never go there.
It's a terrible name, and it's a terrible car. The only thing I can say I liked about driving that thing was that it was quiet and comfortable.
You drove one?
I was a mechanic.
Oh. Okay.
Which, surprisingly enough, it came in for, of all things, an oil change. You're saving the planet. Keep telling yourself that.
Well, Prius is a hybrid. It's not a fully electric vehicle.
Exactly. it also happens.
The only Nissan that I don't actually like.
The Leaf.
The Leaf.
I like the styling of them. Everybody else says they hate it, but it's like, well, at least
I just don't like the whole concept of the Leaf.
At least it kind of pulled off the futuristic styling.
At least it's not a cube.
Futuristic styling got horribly, horribly wrong.
Well, and then everybody tried to copy them. I mean, you got the Scion XB, you got the Ford Flex, you got
toaster cars.
Oh my god,
they are all toaster cars.
They are cubes. They are literal cubes.
Which is why they resemble toasters. My toaster is perfectly square like that. It has a little bit rounded edges so that people can't like cut their fingers open.
My toaster looks like a Grand Caravan. Curves on the edge.
Yeah,
it's weird.
Yeah, because you don't want to cut yourself while having your morning tea and coffee and toast. Yes, people have tea and coffee and toast in.
At the same time. They dip their toast and there's a tea in their coffee.
That would be disgusting.
Yes, it would be.
Let's not talk about food. We're going to give people some terrible ideas and they're going to complain.
They're going to try it and they're going to complain at us. Nice going, Andrew. You suggested it. I just made it better.
In some way, I'm sure you did. It's actually snowing right now.
It's not snowing. Fuck off.
Well, it kind of is.
No, not you. No, snow can fuck off. I've had enough of it this season.
Well, we all have.
But I was in Canada.
Summer tires. I don't want to deal with this.
This is not Canada. There shouldn't be snow at almost April. Okay, it is Canada. But there shouldn't be snow.
Purely because it is Canada. It's just, this is intentionally, they're trying to piss. Who controls the weather?
The Illuminati.
Yeah, the Illuminati is trying to piss us off.
Let's not get into conspiracy theories now.
Even if only for a joke.
Well. Nah, that's good. It's the birds. The birds control the weather, obviously. Because they're controlled by mind control by the Illuminati. That's why they shit all over your cars. Everybody's cars.
What actually did my car the first day of not snowing? And, like, you think, yay, it's finally not snowing. You go inside and there's bird crapped on your car, just to remind you,
you're
going to
have
snow season to bird poop season.
You're going to have white stuff on your car, no matter what season you're in. That includes you guys in Florida. You're going to have white stuff on your car, no matter what.
Fall, at least it turns to yellow.
Yeah, but you're still going to get bird poop on your car in fall.
Theoretically, I suppose. Typically,
maybe not
birds.
Goose crap, but you get bird
poop. No, it's Canada, though. Typically, the birds think it's going to snow in September.
Well, winter's for the birds.
The snowbirds. Were you thinking of something else?
No, I was saying winter's for the birds.
I don't think he was birds. Yeah, you were saying
winter. Tighter enough for that shit.
But to get back to the topic though, do you think of electric cars?
It all depends. They need to figure out how to do lighter batteries. They need to figure out how to do more capacity on the batteries. Once they figure that out, the cars will be a lot faster because of their weight to power ratios.
How about batteries that last longer as well?
That's what I meant. Is if they can find lighter batteries, they can put more batteries in. If they can find more dense batteries, then the density of the battery is how long it lasts. So, like, if you get a AA, it'll last probably a bit longer than a AAA, but they're both running at about the same amperage and the same voltage.
Smaller than the other. Yeah, but would it be nice if you could have capacitors to store a little bit extra charge just in case you...
Capacitors would be like the electric car's version of nitrous. That's about it. It's like a lightning strike. That's it. It's static. It's not, you can't get continuous power out of a capacitor. You can get a static charge out of a capacitor, but you can't get continuous power out of it.
Would it be cool if you could?
It would, but they don't work like that. Like I said, your best bet is if you had a bank of capacitors and you shot them all off in a series.
Because let's remember,
it would act like nitrous.
But like, 30 or 40 years ago, superconductors never really even existed, and then they came.
Still don't exist.
Well, theoretically, they do exist. Though.
Theoretically, they don't exist for the regular consumer.
And
they're
so
fucking expensive to make. A foot long piece of superconductor is about $20,000.
Yes. It's just with LEDs and everything becoming more prevalent, where even LEDs are like the basic function.
Well, yeah, I mean, and there's another caveat of having an electric vehicle is that if you have an electric vehicle, everything is going to use the electricity in a vehicle. With a internal combustion engine, the combustion engine charges the battery as it's being used.
So
whereas
basically, more wraps just means more awesome.
Not really. It just means the battery stays charged.
Yeah.
So when electronics in your vehicle use the battery, then it doesn't really go down.
Yeah, but
if you had enough electronics in your car, your battery would be dead by the time you get home every night.
Yeah.
Most vehicles have enough electronics that they are useful. Not enough electronics that they kill your battery every day.
An alternator is capable of adding back up.
Right.
Like, basically, if you had a 160-amp alternator, you might have 100-amp current to whatever.
Possibly, yeah. I know some of the technology in electric vehicles allows them to charge the batteries a little bit. Their braking systems allow them that.
It's called regenerative braking.
Some internal combustion cars use it too. Less energy is being used from the engine to charge the battery and such.
Yeah.
Albeit it's only a little bit.
But my idea for the electric car, to stem from yours, is just to make it more like a lighter, more efficient system where instead of having electric power steering, why do you need power steering at all? You make a car lighter enough and it doesn't need power.
Because people are bitches.
If you make a car like the MX-5, it doesn't need power steering. People say
it's fair enough. I mean, if you have a light enough car, you don't need power steering because it doesn't put enough weight on the tires for it to be difficult to turn the wheel.
Yeah.
Or like, if you took the power steering out of, say, a Ford F-150, good freaking luck having a skinny person turn that wheel. It's going to be really, really tough. There's a cube, by the way.
We don't like your car.
Speaking of cubes, we just had one drive by on the road out here.
We don't like cubes.
I forgot that Nissan made the cube. So there's two Nissans that I don't like. There's the cube and there's the Leaf.
But the only thing that I don't mind about the Nissan Leaf is that it actually makes sense.
It's just a light enough vehicle, though.
They use LED lights, but they use it smartly because you can make the range longer with LED lights. And I don't even think Prius has gotten to the point where they're using...
Prius has LED turn signals. At the very least, they have the turning signals or LEDs.
But, for example, my WRX has LEDs. And you think, well, that's great. It doesn't need them. This car doesn't have the limited electric range. It just goes until it runs out of petrol. And you put more in and it goes again.
Yes. Yeah, until we run out of petrol.
which hopefully doesn't happen for 200 years.
I don't see why.
I just happen to enjoy. That's a good sound.
Meh. Biased.
Because it doesn't sound like a Nissan.
That's part of it.
Yeah, you can put your RB26 in whatever car you want to when you actually have one.
Yeah. I have my dream car, and so do you, Mr. Hypocrite.
But the NVIDIA Q300 is a good exhaust, and it's a good sound, and that's why I like the petrol right now, is because it's a nice car that I happen to enjoy driving.
Yes. You continue to drive your Hypocrite mobile.
It's the same reason why you like your 240S.
Yes.
That you will someday have, hopefully.
I will have it. It will be mine. I will acquire it. It'll be in my possession. Probably sit in a garage for about 2 years because I don't have enough money to put anything into it. But I'll have it. It'll be like a trophy.
When you have your car sitting in your garage, it just means that you can put labor into it without paying for it.
Exactly. That's I can't drive it.
That's the problem that I have with this car is that it's not in the garage right now. Because otherwise I would be painting the calipers and everything to make it look just a little bit better, because right now the calipers are hideous.
Calipers are blue.
On this car? You better hope they're not blue.
Subaru.
Riley. There's, like, never been a Subaru with blue calipers.
Blue side.
There's, like, 3 aftermarket Subarus where they have AP brake systems, and yes, they have blue calipers. But every Subaru I can think of has black, gold, or red. And red is aftermarket, but it's just the most common.
That's true. Second most common being black, right?
Well, black isn't even aftermarket.
No, but I mean, in terms of aftermarket colors, black would be the second most, right?
Black would be the most common aftermarket color, I think. Or maybe aside from red, or red is second most, or something like that, but somewhere in there, it's black and it's red are the two most common
colors.
Let's
just hope people don't start making chrome vehicles. We don't need that shit.
They already have. Dubai.
That's gross. Why would you do that?
Well, did you not see any when you were in Dubai?
No.
Lucky man.
I saw plenty of Lamborghinis and high-priced exotic vehicles.
So it's basically just a trip to Toronto?
No. It was a trip to downtown Toronto. But the whole city was like that.
Bathurst. Or Quebec City. Did you know Quebec City? They have nice cars.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Second, you go into the old city, you go down to the club district.
I'm not making fun of the French.
In Quebec City.
Don't even try. This isn't happening.
Moi, je parle français. Pourquoi est-ce que je me moquerais de...
Shut up your face.
Pourquoi est-ce que je me moquerais de...
Tu es dans le bagno.
I don't know why I would make fun of the French. I am French, so it would be kind of... He just said he is the bathroom.
No, I said you are the bathroom. In Spanish. I believe.
That's exactly what you said. But you just... I don't even know what to say at that point.
Exactly. Just shuts you up. It's beautiful. Works every time. Works wonders for me.
Anyways.
Anywho. Back to electric vehicles. Keep getting off topic. It's perfect.
I actually love the many different cultures of the world, which is why I speak 4 languages and everything. It's just sometimes people like to laugh at me for it.
I speak 1.5.
You see?
But I understand like 5.
If we're gonna go by that, I understand like 6.
Yes. I understand 5 because you keep speaking 3 different languages at me consistently.
I'm teaching it.
Slowly. By force.
I'm really waiting until somebody actually makes a sort of mass-produced MX-5.
Well, okay, so here's the problem with current electric vehicles. right now they're using lithium ion batteries. Most of them are. Some of them are using the polymer ones, which is what I'm suggesting. Polymer batteries, lithium polymer batteries are much lighter than lithium ion batteries. Much lighter. By like half, at least. If everybody started using lithium polymer batteries, or they made a new technology that was lighter than even the lithium polymer batteries, I'm sure it's something out there, then that would fix the whole battery weight problem. Or they put more in, which fixes the distance problem. One way or the other, it fixes an issue that we seem to be having.
Because you could put two times as many in the same weight.
Right.
Because they're about half as heavy.
Right.
But to put that into perspective, in the petrol car's average battery being somewhere around like 30 to 40 kilograms, roughly, it would go down to 15.
I could lift a battery on my own.
It would go down to somewhere in like 15 to 20 kilograms. Where you know that you can lift them, but they're heavy, right?
Fuck, they're heavy.
They're very heavy. That's one of the things that we both kind of agree on, is that the best electric cars...
Well, they're using kilograms, by the way.
I'm Canadian. Deal with it.
I learned in pounds. Pounds are for weight, sir.
You're more Canadian than I am, where you're confused between your units. You switch between them. Oh, it's that many feet. Oh, it's that many kilometers. Oh,
excuse me. Kilometers are for long distances. Feet are for short distances and height.
And there you have it.
Feet are for height.
This is why Canada never does anything awesome. We're too busy arguing about units of measurement.
But anyway, for those of you that use pounds, batteries about 40.
Which basically means it's pretty heavy.
It's damn heavy. It's about a third of me.
Yeah. You can actually buy batteries that are like 2 pounds, 5 pounds, somewhere in there.
Yeah, most of them are lithium polymer batteries.
They cost $600.
Most of them are lithium polymer batteries, and they'll have the same power as the lead acid batteries that are in current vehicles.
But they cost $600.
Yes.
$600.
That's another thing that electric vehicles have a problem with, is price point.
Yes.
If you started using friggin' lithium polymer batteries, you'd probably jump your price a good $10,000 at least. For
the price of an electric car.
Price of the electric car. If they can figure out how to make them a little more cheaper, send it over to...
But what I've had an idea of...
It's a horrible idea. Don't ever do that.
Is, would it be possible to make the frame and chassis underneath out of electric batteries?
That's what some people have tried. See,
I think
the
some
thing
people
is,
have done
is, I mean, if you use lead-acid batteries, obviously, if you hit something on the bottom chassis, if you don't have a skid plate, you got friggin' acid on the road. Citric acid. Sulfuric acid. Most of the time it's sulfuric acid.
Sulfuric, you're right, yeah.
Which will burn through pretty much anything.
Sulfur is like its own thing, that isn't it mixed with phosphor?
I don't know. I think it may be because it doesn't burn through the casing of the battery that it's in.
See, this is a thing that I never actually went through when I was in the college learning to work on the cars, is what forms the actual acid that goes into the battery. We were taught about that there's sulfuric acid, but they never actually bothered to say, yeah, this is what sulfuric acid actually is.
No. Sulfuric acid is usually what they use for...
I think the whole idea with the chemistry is not really something that mechanics care about.
No, not particularly.
I don't think I'm one of them.
But in any case, if you knock the bottom off of a lead acid battery, you're going to get acid everywhere. Possibly melt your back tires. or the road.
The drifters would be proud. Kill all the tires!
Literally melt your back and melt your tires.
10 blocks. Just 10 blocks.
Yeah. Maybe your rims.
He doesn't care about his rims. It's like Crazy Leo with his picture. Oh, you stop because you have flat tires? Oh, that's cute. And he's just got the tire that's shredded on the rim. And he's still airborne. It's just one of those things that separates rally drivers, isn't it?
Yeah.
The willingness to torture your car and just laugh about it.
Yeah, and this guy doesn't want to go on dirt roads.
I have very expensive summer wheels. I was very, very happy to go down gravel roads with my winter wheels. The summer wheels are too nice.
It's like Dan's black on the rim. It's a maximum. They fit the vehicle nice.
I wasn't a fan of the black wheels ever, so...
I think that they fit his vehicle very nicely.
Yeah.
Well, it could be like that vehicle right there with no rim. No stylized rim. It's got the
even steel wheels can still be stylized. It's with the color.
It's true.
If you have rust colored wheels...
Rust is lighter than carbon.
The engineer in me just wants to scream and smack you.
I got a couple of buddies in another car group that Andrew doesn't know or may have pissed off. I don't know. There's the car that used to meet up at Pepe's Pizza, but I kind of stuck it.
I've never met them.
Really? They remember you.
They remember me.
Yes.
Huh? How could they possibly remember me?
They don't always meet there. Car enthusiasts. They run into each other and they don't remember each other, apparently.
Well, apparently they remember me.
Yeah, they remember you when I asked them about you about a year ago. Doesn't matter. In any case, there's a couple of the Civic drivers. They have, rusty hoods with no holes in them. Stickers on, so rust is there. So yes, back to topic. Lighter batteries. Denser batteries.
Ways that electric cars are better for enthusiasts than enthusiasts are better for electric cars. Efficiency.
Practical. I have a practical example. When you were go-karting, we wanted to electric convert your go-kart. That would have been sick if we could have figured out how to do it.
Well, we could have if we had had the budget to get the stepper motors and everything.
Well, stepper motors would have been the best bet, but still, I mean, you could still do it with a DC motor. Stepper motors just have a shit ton of torque.
Which is what you need for cars, because, you know, they're lightweight and they would make it.
DC motors also have a shit ton of torque. It's the way that the torque is done. Stepper motors, you would have to have something that steps between all the steps in sequence every time, faster and faster as you make the motor go faster. Whereas DC motors, you just put more voltage into it. The more voltage you put into it, the faster the motor goes.
Yeah. I feel like the DC motors have run out of juice pretty quickly in the go-kart application.
You can stop a DC motor. Stop. You can't very well stop a stepper motor. That's the only thing.
You mean, like, with throttle on-off type thing?
No. Like, if you put a bar on a DC motor, like a straight bar, and it was spinning, it was spinning slowly, and you grab the bar, you could stop that motor. Whereas with a stepper motor, it would turn you. You can't stop it. It has much more torque.
Like an actual
particularly, but it's each torque. The torque is much higher because the torque is split between each step, as opposed to the torque being for the whole revolution.
Yeah.
So each time you do a step, it's a shit ton of torque from A to B. As opposed to with a DC motor, it's from A to A.
Yeah.
But yes, practical example. A little bit.
Just
fun.
Fun interest because figuring out how it works, like saving the environment in a budget racing go-kart.
Yeah.
Basically just figuring out how.
The only problem was figuring out the horsepower on an electric motor.
You can kind of, well.
Because you guys were only allowed to use, what, 6 horsepower engines on those go-karts?
They wouldn't even have been allowed in the sanctioning anyways, because the torque and everything would be entirely different from Honda GX200.
Yeah, because one more engine.
That's exactly what it is. On what essentially amounts
it's
to
about,
the
it's
cheapest,
a, it's about the
best.
It's about the best thing that Honda makes.
It's the cheapest form of motorsports. So, when you want to talk to somebody about the absolute grassroots motorsports, it is karting. That's where everybody gets their start, because it's inexpensive fun. And then that's when you step into the Formula Ford is the next step, and the Formula One, and the Formula whichever. Formula 3, Formula Masters, I don't care. But
Drew starts driving Formula 1, that'll be the day.
Max Verstappen is like 5 years younger than I am.
I know.
And he's in Formula 1. And you think, how is he possibly mentally stable enough? He's almost at the age where the reaction to being passed is, well, he's not actually faster than me, I'm a good driver, Smash. yeah, you do.
Pit maneuvers on Tsukuba.
But not in real life.
No, never. Never in real life.
Yeah.
Repair bus would be too much.
What, 23 now?
23.
Yeah. So, of course,
it'd be 24 in July.
You have grown to the point where you're no longer tempted to just crash into things that are faster than you because they're faster.
I also haven't driven a car in, like, 3 years.
But even when I was karting, I didn't actually crash into things just purely because I was more...
No, you crash into things because you couldn't control your kart. If that ever happened, you were rather a good driver.
There was one time when I was bumped into somebody else, and I felt bad about it. There was another time where somebody just didn't know I was there, and but that's sort of the thing though, isn't it, that Formula E is very good racing. It's very closely matched and everything, and I don't think electric cars are the end of the enthusiasts, so as people think they are. But that is an example of a car which, despite being electric, is still very good fun. That's a car that has sequential gearbox. It's not a manual per stick and clutch, but it is a manual in that it has flappy
gears.
Paddles.
It has gears that you can change.
With paddle lever.
I always wondered if you could actually change a manual lever to flappy paddles.
Well, you can. Can do. Oh yeah, you just talk to whichever shop you prefer and they do it.
I mean, you're dating 240 with that. Black pants. Six speed.
Yeah. But a lot of people seem to think that the electric cars would be the end, though. And I'm thinking,
no. Just like we thought airplanes would be.
Eventually, I'll learn who's driving in it. Truly, Yarno Truly, for example. If they can enjoy the racing enough, that even after coming from Formula One and getting into Formula E, that they still enjoy it, then it's not really the end, is it? People who have experienced the pinnacle of motorsports and have driven the cars that most people would think are like the absolute pinnacle of driving pleasure, and they still think that the Formula E cars are good enough to race them.
Just saying, I think it would be hilarious if we took a Formula One driver and stuck him in a rally car.
You mean like Kimi Raikkonen or Roman Kubica?
Or the other way. Maybe rally car drivers in the
Formula One. You mean like Kimi Raikkonen?
Do you go back and forth?
Yeah, he does.
Where'd he start though?
He was Formula One. He went to rally and he crashed too much.
Gotta have the other way. Gotta have the other way.
Crazy Leo for Formula One. He's gonna race against all the four people left by the time he gets there.
Well, look, one of those chainsaw guys is coming back with a log on his shoulder. I don't see any trees missing.
Well, I think what happened is one of the trees would have been sick. It would have fallen onto the trail. Had to cut the tree back.
That would make sense. But why do you need 8 guys to cut a tree?
Because it's a big tree. Having seen the tree that fell, it's a big tree. It looks like a mighty task. That's why I didn't do anything about it. If it's just a small tree, I'll do it myself, but it's a massive thing.
As a recap, in case you just joined us.
In case you just joined us halfway through a YouTube video. Anyway.
Well, in case your friend just walked in behind you, we need to figure out a way to make electric vehicles both more fun and more efficient. Efficient being lighter batteries, more dense batteries, and...
just basically longer range, less right. Emissions.
Well, you...
Make it the best car you can make it.
I mean, some electric vehicles still have, like, a little tiny lawnmower, 2-horsepower lawnmower engine in the back to charge the batteries in case you get stuck somewhere. I mean, they have that backup, but they don't use it. They don't need it. If you had denser and lighter batteries, you also wouldn't need it because you'd be able to have that distance. You'd have 100, 200.
Which they do now, but in the middle of the winter, it goes down to like minus.
Right, because you have extra friction.
Yeah,
not friction. Resistance.
The resistance.
Yeah, the snow and the ice.
Friction is kind of resistance.
Well, yeah, but friction's different. Friction would be when you're driving down an asphalt road.
Yeah.
You'd have friction.
But the resistance.
Driving through snow, you have resistance.
The resistance is the internal resistance in the battery.
The resistance would be through the motor as opposed to the batteries. The batteries are always the same way. The motor would get more resistant in the winter because the metal would be contracting in the summertime, which is where it's supposed to be. In the wintertime, it would constrict, so it would get smaller.
Yeah.
It would make it less.
But I was doing research on this particular episode of From the Driver's Seat video.
Oh, on that point, I did no research.
What I found was that people were driving in the summertime and they could get, let's say, 90 kilometers, 100 kilometers in a day in the Nissan Leaf. But in the wintertime, when it fell to maybe -5 in one particular video, it went to 40 kilometers. And I'm thinking, Tesla has all those supercharger stations and everything, and that's very great. It's all fine, and that works perfectly well. But in the middle of the winter, in Canada, for example, when the next supercharger station is 60 kilometers away and your range is 40,
you're going to have a problem.
That's why you need to kind of think about ways that you can make it more efficient. Even if you have, let's say, optional power steering where you can run the car without the power steering.
Or just optional features that are optional if you need the range, like emergency optional features. So you can turn your power steering off, you can turn your power windows off, you can turn... how about we just don't have power windows, because they're horrible anyway. Go back to rule. Cranks are much better. Especially if you get dunked in the...
Just gonna roll down the window that I can't reach to make a point.
Yeah, I can reach it.
Yeah, but if you're not in the car,
then you reach your own damn window. What I'm saying is, it's also good for emergency situations that you dunk your electric car in the river. But even still, for that, having a roll down window is much safer. Roll down windows are a safety feature. Power windows, seriously, wild. They could be disabled. Power steering could be disabled. Automatic environmental control can be disabled. Turn your fans on when you need them. Whatever.
Yeah.
Radio can be disabled. Like,
and that's the sort of thing that the enthusiast would think about, but the average driver would be, I don't want to do that.
Well, I mean, okay, so you think about this. People that do engine conversions on an engine that is not from their vehicle, the LS1 comes to mind.
Everyone swaps LS1 into RX7 because rotaries really aren't that great.
The LS1 comes to mind. The 2JZ and 1JZ come to mind. That guy that put the Corvette engine in his 240 comes to mind.
See, that's not even that bad.
That was
a lot better than the people who think that rotary is crap.
Dude, the friggin' transmission was like to here. Literally here in the car.
Because you've got such a good power to weight ratio, and the weight distribution front to rear.
Well, the engine goes up there.
The shifter is right there, it doesn't have to be a shifter.
I think the shifter was like back here.
It was? Okay, on this car, the shifter is actually right there. But that's because it's all wheel drive. It actually has.
Yes, I know.
But if you have the Civic, for example, the transmission is, like, way up there.
Wait a second, it wasn't a 240, it was a Civic. It was the Corvette engine and a Civic. It was a hatchback Civic, too.
I've never actually seen that.
How
have I not seen
it? I ran into this video randomly on the internet. I'll have to show you some of these videos now.
Yeah, because I actually saw the 240SX with an LS.
No, not an LS1. It was, like, an old-school Corvette engine, like, from the 80s.
Stingray.
It was one of those big-ass engines. As opposed to the LS1, which would fit under the bottom. Whatever.
See, I think... Well, the LS1, maybe, I don't think they're as big as you think, maybe.
It was big enough that he had to cut out a good section of the dash to fit the transmission into the vehicle.
But the Civic, for example, the typical Civic, you've got the transmission between the front wheels.
Yes.
The shifter way back here.
Because front wheel drive. But yes.
Yeah. Well, that's why this car has this one here, is because it actually has the transmission right there.
Right. No, I get that. I know why the shifter is right there.
Well, I'm not explaining it specifically to you.
Okay. I kind of got that.
Are you the sort of guy who, when somebody asks for somebody by name, and it's not even your name, you still answer?
No, that doesn't happen.
Thank you.
But if somebody calls out my name, I turn around.
And then you find out that they were talking about the other...
Right. And then I figure out that they were calling over to a woman. Fucking elementary schools. Thin polymer batteries, I believe, are the best batteries that we have at current technology levels.
Yeah.
For power to weight. Lithium polymer batteries are also the batteries that electric conversion bicycle people use for their conversion units. So if we started using those in more commonly electric vehicles, we could probably reduce the weight that it's being. Being there from the lithium ions. Funnily enough, lithium ions are also the batteries that are used in laptops.
In order to make them lighter and smaller as well.
You wouldn't want a lead acid battery in your laptop, man.
I remember there was a time when
there was a couple of them, yeah.
Huge.
I still have one.
Shows the weight savings.
The iPad Air being a perfect example of bullshit.
Well, fair enough. But
I am a biased person. I will put that out there.
But
yes, what? It is a perfect example of how technology is getting smaller.
It's perfect parallel as well. The laptop technology parallels the car technology, the automotive technology.
Come to think of it, actually, I think the iPad Air uses lithium polymer batteries.
Well,
because they're thinner.
That's why we started talking about it. But I think the true idea behind the electric car of the future is just making it as efficient as possible by controlling the amounts of unnecessary accessories. It's sort of coming back to basics again, where I think
in the early
2010s we had a whole bunch of accessories that people really weren't necessarily making. You look back
in like the 1970s and 1980s you had the muscle cars down in the States, and you had the European vehicles. I mean, you look at those cars from that era, there was no power steering in the Dodge Dart from the 70s. Look at the Dodge Dart that they got now. Well, although it looks like shit. It has all of these unnecessary features that the original one never had. Has power steering, it's got power windows, it's got whatever that, the Ford or Dodge nav system thing in the dash that uses a crap ton of juice. You didn't have that in old muscle cars. And then you go over to Europe, you look at the old Volvos, you look at the old Audis. Audi was ahead of their time for technology advances, but still, the older ones, they didn't have any of this technology that the newer ones do. And then, continuing on to that, you look at the Asian market as well, the Nissans and the Hondas. All of these Honda Civics that people are using for their so-called street race vehicles, they still don't have as much technology as, say, a Honda Prius does.
Honda Prius?
Honda Prius.
Honda Prius, everyone.
Toyota Prius. Toyota Prius. I don't know these other Japanese manufacturers. Nissan. Doesn't work. Honda Prius. Whatever. Toyota Prius has so many electric things in it that are such a waste for electric power that it has a thing that tells you where the electricity is going in your car. You don't even need that. I know where the electricity is going in my car. It's going to my wheels. Thank you.
Well, it tells you whether it's being recharged or being discharged.
Yes, but it has these like arrow things. It's like, hey, this is where it's going. Oh, wait, you're braking? Now it's going this way.
I think it's just an interesting infographic for the whole You're saving the environment. Keep it up.
Yeah, something like that.
Demographic. Where the people who buy it are the sort of conscientious people who want to make a difference, but they're making the difference by not doing research and buying a car, which isn't necessarily as good for the environment as they think.
You look at the Priuses, I mean, how many of them got recalled for brake failure in their first year?
Regenerative problems.
Yeah, no, brake failure.
Yeah.
Literal brake failure. Like, they couldn't stop.
I know that. But they also have regenerative problems with the brake.
This is true, they still have those. But, I mean, if you... Getting back to the whole too many features thing, I mean, you put your own AC, you put your own heating on when you need it. You don't need to have automatic climate control in your vehicle. It doesn't make sense. Power windows don't make, well, they make a little bit of sense, but they don't make much sense.
If you have like a Rolls Royce or something.
Yeah, okay. That's a nice, that's a luxury car, though.
It means you don't have to roll the window down and tell the driver, hey, can you put the AC on, please? Because you don't drive that car yourself.
This is true.
Nobody drives those cars themselves.
They have climate control on it. That's a limo, though. That's not a Rolls Royce. What do you want?
Rolls Royce and limos and all that stuff, they're all crap from a driving point of view. We're enthusiasts. We like driving our own cars.
Not a bad car.
I just wouldn't drive one. Hello, happy, friendly guy. Have a nice day.
Yes, go away from me with your chainsaw. That was one of the chainsaw guys.
Yeah. It's not like he's hurting anybody. He's just clearing a path from a tree to fell.
So no.
Maybe he's just taking firewood out. Making sure that the forest is...
need to find ways to also decrease the amount of power that things that are needed take as well. Like your headlights. Going LED is a perfect idea.
For daytime running lights. There are some...
For the night lights as well. They have super bright LEDs.
Oh yeah, like the Matrix lights. They have one.
They're beautiful. They're beautiful for headlights.
Yeah.
They're blinding. They're beautiful. The lights.
Blinding.
You and your complaints about people in their high beams when they weren't high beams.
No, that's HIDs and halogen housings.
Right.
High intensity discharge. It's completely different from light emitting guidance.
But you could also have, you can have LED with the reflecting cones that could do that as well.
Which is even worse than the HIDs and halogen housings.
That's true.
If your car is designed for it, yes, it would be fine. I know, for example, the Chevrolet Cruze, they've made the switch in order to save the electrical gremlins.
It's true.
They've got the LED driving lights and the LED night lights, if you will, the full beam.
Night lights.
That's what you called it the first time you climbed. They're called bull beams. Use the term bull beam for
high beams.
High beams is the different thing from the bull beam.
It's the blue light on your dash.
Yes. Okay, and if you drive in Honda Civic from 2007 to 2011, and you see a bright blue light on your dash, and it's bright, that means your high beams are on. Please turn them back off. You do not understand how your dash works, and I know Honda was stupid to design their car that way, but you have to be smarter than the engineers. Please. Thank you.
And that's his rant about Honda Civics for the day.
The Civics
or for the hour.
It's the designer's fault, or the engineer's fault, or the driver's fault. I don't blame the car for it. Subaru can have some stupid car drivers, too. Kidding! Probably crashed into a whole bunch of trees.
So, in conclusion, lighter batteries, more dense batteries for for that type of battery, lithium polymer, more dense lithium polymer batteries.
Put them lower in the car.
Put them lower in the car.
Whatever center of gravity. Center of the car, weight distribution, front to rear.
Less features. Well, less required features.
You can have them.
You can still have features, but make them so that they can be turned off should you get stuck in a situation where you're too far from a charge station. You're going to be getting a boost in the boonies.
15 kilometers away with 12 kilometers of the